talk a little bit about what we expect to see out of SLU this year, do a little bit of a deep dive into KenPom and T-Rank. If you're familiar with both of those, they're two awesome stats websites where you can find out literally anything you wish to know about college basketball, and kind of just talk about what we expect to see out of SLU this year. But before we get to that point, we're going to talk about how SLU finished the season and kind of why those last six games or so, five games, whatever it is, why we think that that is going to, you know, lead into a good 2020/2021 season. So, Dan, I think you have pulled up kind of like the numbers from the last five games, six games, whatever it was. So do you want to just kind of walk us through that and say what you think about them?
Yeah, so I know that we've tweeted this out before, but if you're watching the last five games of the year, last year, starting with obviously that BCU game and including St. Joe's, Rhode Island, George Mason, and St. Bonaventure, SLU was riding pretty high, obviously, going into the conference tournament, or what we thought was going to be the conference tournament. And metrically, so based on their adjusted offense and adjusted defense, they're actually third in the country aggregating those values. And that was really driven by the defense, honestly, because the offense was still down at about 78, which obviously we know that their offense isn't anything super special. We're not going to score in a high volume most games, but I mean, that defense was number three that whole stretch. And I know that we just discussed the different line of usages or one or two of them through that span. And I think that those guys that were on the floor did a lot of that defensive work. And that's what I think we can probably see to start the year this year.
Yeah, so you had mentioned the lineup usage thing. KenPom is a really cool feature where it takes your most frequent lineups of your last five games. And when, even though SLU's offense was still down in the 70s, like you said, they started doing something that they hadn't really done most of the year, and that was playing small. So that frequent lineup that they ran with 26% of the time, and I would expect to see something similar this year, was they ran Yuri Collins at the point, Terrence Hargrove at the shooting guard spot. They had Goodwin shift down to small forward, even though he's only about 6'3". Javante Perkins at the four, and then Hassan at the five. While they were giving up some height, we know that Perkins and Goodwin for sure play a lot bigger than they really are. So it kind of made up for any defensive liabilities you might typically have with a shorter lineup. But it really allowed them to get out and play a lot more in transition. And, you know, kind of, even though they weren't like firing on all cylinders like someone like Dayton or Richmond did for most of the year, it allowed them to really get out and run and maximize this open court playmaking ability that a guy at point guard like Yuri Collins really affords Travis Ford to run. And I'm not entirely sure if that's going to carry over like immediately from last year, because as we'll talk about later, there are some new lineup combinations they can go with. There's a few guys coming back from injury. We have a transfer in Martin Linson and a few freshmen who are going to factor into this rotation based on everything that Travis has said in the preseason. But, you know, it's going to be interesting to see if they do opt to go with these smaller lineups more often and just get a little bit more offense, because really the story of the Travis Ford era at SLU is defense is their calling card, but offense, the years or the games when their offense is working, it's really hard to beat SLU. It just is.
Right. And I mean, even if you want to, select those games and say, you know, it was only 3 weeks, it was only five games, is that really sustainable? And while, you know, some of those defensive metrics may not be entirely sustainable, we certainly don't expect them to be for, you know, the entirety of the season. I mean, you look at some of these other names that were in that top 10, and I mean, Dayton is in there, and, you know, Seton Hall and Oregon and Kansas, Wisconsin, Michigan State. I mean, you see some of these teams in there, and I mean, those teams played with that type of efficiency all year long that, you know, it's tough to swing with those big dogs, but we expect to be pretty close, to be honest.
Well, and I think that an important point is, while a lot of SLU fans, us included, are high on this team, they really don't have to swing with those big dogs for most of the season because they are in the Atlantic 10. Like, no disrespect to the league, but you know, you're really only going to have four or five teams that you're competing against for a bid. At the end of the day, that's what it boils down to. So, like, you're going to have to play like a big dog against Richmond, Dayton, Duquesne, who, you know, if SLU can beat Duquesne this year, I'll be happy. I think SLU's a better team than Duquesne, but that's, like, the world's worst matchup. Right. And, like, Bonaventure, maybe Davidson in Kellen Grady's senior year, they put something together. But, like, you really, most of your games in this conference, if you're looking at the talent SLU has on paper, they really shouldn't be nail-biters. They should be games that you walk away and win. But you're going to make your money, so to speak, on those games against teams that are also, you know, top 75, top 100 teams.
Right. And I mean, as we look, I guess, closer to what, next week now, this week, actually. And I mean, you look towards Wednesday and, you know, SIUE, who's, you know, maybe not supposed to be the best team, but you never know how your team can come out, especially in the first match of the year. But then you've got these early tests in LSU and in, you know, away against Minnesota. And while those guys may not be the absolute cream of the crop of their individual conferences, I mean, those are still tough matchups. LSU still was the first team in the AP, like, receiving votes. So, I mean, those are still big challenges. And while it's not a Kansas or, you know, a Creighton or a Michigan State, it's still, you know, somebody who those are the teams that you have to beat to prove your worth to get into the tournament at the end of the year.
Correct. So I think that's a great place to transition to this season. So obviously non-con is going to happen first, as it does every year, but with how much shifting has taken place this year because of COVID scheduling, I mean, we saw it with the Billikens too. They were initially in Orlando, then Nebraska, and then Nebraska fell apart. So now they're just hosting their own kind of mini MTE, even though it's really just a two-game thing with SIU and LSU. You know, if you look at this non-conference schedule that SLU has put together, they really have two games that can help them. And they have a lot of games that, at best, are going to do nothing to improve their resume. The two games that can help them are, of course, LSU at home, which right now both T-Rank and KenPom are projecting that as a slight win for SLU. But on KenPom specifically, it's basically a toss-up. He has a projected score of 73-71. So, I mean, it's generally understood in college basketball that 3 points is about your home court advantage. So that's basically a toss-up. He thinks they're even. Whereas T-Rank has SLU as about a 6.5-point favorite. He has 79-73. But, you know, between LSU and then the other one of Minnesota, which I believe both of them have projected SLU to lose, but by very small margins. You know, those two games are your only non-conference games against anything under 200. I guess
Indiana State's on the schedule.
Indiana State is on the schedule. They're 93. So,
yeah, so I see them at sub 100. So that'll be important game.
So it's a home game, though. So I think that would be a Q2 for net, which eventually we'll start incorporating like bracketologists and their net analysis into these shows, but they don't have any info yet for this year. But I mean, if you're looking, this game against SIU Ebersville, like, no disrespect to them, it should be a 20-point win easily.
At least. You saw how they opened against Florida Gulf Coast last year.
Yeah.
And I think that we're probably expecting a similar result to that, where you just come out and you run and gun and you take your shots and you play your defense. And that defense, even if those shots don't fall, that defense should be enough to get the job done by 20 plus.
Yeah. And I think that LSU is the one that is going to, you're going to be able to glean more like kind of what the talent level of this team truly is. So I believe, I don't know if we had been recording it or not, but you said they were returning like 94% of their scoring, 92% of minutes. Does that sound right?
So
around there? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So they're returning, I believe, 91.8% of their minutes and then 94% of their possession minutes. And so, you know, you're losing a few guys who were you know, pretty important to Leicester's day. I mean, you look at a guy like Tay Weaver or even Casey Hankton, and they had their important minutes.
Yeah.
But obviously, you know, those aren't the main headliners of the team. And so you're returning that core and you're returning those guys who are on the floor for 30 plus minutes a game. And, and that's what's going to be important.
And I think that this is as good of a place as any to talk about. So like what Slew's getting back. So we already know what Goodwin is. We know what French is. We were talking earlier today. If they don't improve at all from what they've done the last 3 years, last year specifically, you know, you're not really angry. You're not really shaking your head. You're not really doing anything because they're known commodities. They are the only duo to average a double-double in college basketball last year. Jordan Goodwin is, if not the best, the second best rebounding guard in college basketball. We know what we're going to get with them in terms of shooting, specifically from the free throw line. If you get a little bit of improvement out of them from the field or the free throw line, that's great. I'm not like banking on it. You're of course getting back Javonte Perkins. And the question with him is going to be, is he the player that he was the last 12 or so games of the year? Or is he more of the player in line with his season averages, which I believe he was about 15 points a game for the season? If he's that and not this like hyper efficient, meteoric score that he showed over the last 4 weeks of the season, maybe you're not as good as you think you are. I don't think he has to be that like insane scorer that he was, but I mean, I'd love it. Javonte Perkins rules, great player. And elite. Elite. And I think that he is, I don't know. I think he has the best shot at the NBA of the three seniors, but maybe that's a incorrect scouting assessment. I really don't know. I'm not a pro. And then, of course, you have the other starter. I'm pretty sure you can pencil in is Yuri Collins. He's kind of the straw that stirs the drink. All you're really looking for out of him is just to improve his turnover numbers, because that was like the one real deficiency in his game last year. And some people attribute it to having two banged up wrists for most of the year. I mean, I really don't know. I'll stop talking so much, but then the next two big additions, and Travis has hinted at probably them flipping off who starts, are you get Fred Thatch back after he was out most of last year with an illness. And then you also get Gibson Jimerson back after he missed all but 10 games, I believe, with a broken foot. So you're going to get a big-time defender in Thatch, who, to this point, we really don't know what he is offensively, and you're going to get maybe a top-five shooter in the conference back in Jimerson. So,
right, and I think that aside from, you know, the four that you listed first, so the three seniors plus Yuri, I think that you're going to see probably a little bit of rotation just depending on what that opposing lineup looks like. So, you know, if they've got, you know, a couple of really strong players that you need to really lock up, I wouldn't be surprised to see Fred Thatch start and just really put the clamps down early. If you need some early scoring and, you know, maybe you see the game as kind of more of an open contest, you might leave Jimerson in there just to hit a couple quick threes. And even if they have a guy that's a power big, or maybe they've got two bigger guys in their starting lineup, maybe 2 6'9" plus, 6'10" plus, I think you could see Jimmy Bell in the lineup yet. And I don't think it's going to be really the same lineup every single game. I think that maybe by the time you get to mid-January to February, you might start to see a little bit more consistency. But I think that you're going to see a lot of rotation. And at the end of the day, I mean, it doesn't really matter who's on the floor at the beginning, because Travis is just going to switch out those rotations. And you're going to see a lot of Terrence. You're going to see a lot of Jacobs. You're going to see pretty much a lot of everybody. And with so many shooters now, or I guess with more shooters than we've usually had in the past, and just more what I'd call reliable scorers, I think you're going to see Travis go with the hot hand a lot. I mean, whether it's Jacobs, whether it's Perkins. I mean, if Perkins has a bad game, I could see him pulling him out and putting in, you know, Gibson just to see what he can do.
Yeah, and I think one last touch I'd like to make on the rotation. We didn't mention everybody, and if it seems like we're mentioning a lot of names, this, knock on wood, should be Travis's deepest team he's had at SLU. I think with the fact that his first couple of years he played like 7-man rotations, this is definitely a different roster construction than he's had in recent years. But what I was going to say is, like, you know, I think an ideal for this season, honestly, is that your big three, so to speak, don't have to be playing 35 minutes a game. Right. And I think that Travis will play them between 32 and 35 minutes a game, but I would hope that you have enough games where you're up 12-15, you know, with 4 minutes left, and you can say, okay, we can give Jordan a couple minutes here, we can give Hassan a couple minutes, we can reduce their load in these times where you just really don't need them. And I mean, I think that a lot of conference games aren't going to be these massive blowouts because conference basketball typically isn't, but maybe just browsing what both of these sites think these non-conference scores are going to be, you know, you might be able to get your guys some rest in non-con just to tune them up before conference actually kicks off with Duquesne.
Right. And I think that one more area where the deeper roster is really important is with the foul trouble. I mean, you know, we see, and it's obviously not every game, but we see, you know, Hassan with a quick two or maybe three by halftime. And it happens with Jordan sometimes. And it happens to guys that you're going to give a lot of minutes to. And, you know, it's just part of the game. But I think that Travis knows that, you know, the deeper roster this year lets him kind of experiment and test other guys. And I mean, in crunch time, you still want Jordan out there. In crunch time, you still want Hassan and Javante and all those guys out there. I get it. But, you know, at the end of the first half, it kind of allows you to take, you know, a guy like Jordan Goodwin out and not feel really, really exposed to, you know, the other team going on a big run.
Yeah. So I want to take the time to ask. So give me like two or three games that you're looking at on the schedule that you kind of have circled as like, I don't know, you're looking forward to the most, just big time, just, you know, whatever you want to say, because I think I have a few.
We're talking both non-con and conference?
Give me one non-con and a couple conference, whatever you want to do. I think non-con, sure. it's going to be one of two games. So
sure. I mean, I think my non-con game, honestly, I'm looking for, I mean, I'm very excited for the LSU game. I think the one I'm looking forward to more is the one away to Minnesota. I mean, so, a lot of these both, go ahead.
So I was going to say, I agree with you in the sense that, like, even though Minnesota is going to be a back half of the Big Ten team, they're going to finish probably.
I don't know. I mean, Kenpom and T-Ring both have them in the top like 35.
So yeah, right.
I mean, granted, it's preseason, but
Kenpom has them at 30. I mean, the Big Ten is going to be deep. Like the Big Ten and Big East are always pretty deep, but
right.
You know, I think that Minnesota game is the one I'm looking at more too, because that's going to be a Q1 game because you're playing at Minnesota.
Right. And I think who that's going to be a big kind of, and we've talked about this the last couple of years, but, there's going to be a big grow up game for certain players.
Yeah. It's a gut check.
Different spots. And I think that Minnesota is going to be a big grow up game for Jurie, because Marcus Carr, and I guess I can't say with 100% certainty that Jurie's going to be on him, but I mean, Marcus Carr is their 6'2" guard. I mean, he's supposed to have about a 35% assist rate, and he's got a pretty high usage. It seems like a guy that Jurie's going to guard. Yeah. I can't say that I know Minnesota's roster all that well, but I mean, he's the shortest guy. He's going to be the shortest guy on the floor. And so I think that that's going to be a big test game for Jurie.
Yeah. I mean, they always could end up putting Jordan on him just because he is your defensive stopper.
Right.
Unless Thatch kind of shows you that he can handle that workload.
Right.
Because, you know, no one really knows what Fred's stamina is going to be. The fact that he's back and playing, some people have kind of viewed as a, you know, a really positive in its own right. But no one knows for sure if he's going to be a guy, you know, he comes off the lost year and he's playing 25, 30 minutes a game. No one knows.
Right.
But you're right. That could be a big grow-up game for Jurie. That could be but it also could be a challenge game for Jordan, or, you know, just your general perimeter rotation in general, because we do know that Travis likes to throw a lot of different defensive looks at people. He loves that 1-3-1 zone. He loves the 2-3 matchup zone that they play pretty regularly. He likes, obviously, a dose of man. He likes to throw a bunch of different stuff at people. So
right.
There's nothing to say that, like, one guy is going to be fully responsible, and that's for any game. Sure. I mean, that's even against SIU Edwardsville.
Sure. No, I get that, and that's – I guess I'm not trying to say that, you know, should they lose to Minnesota that, you know, that's going to be Uri's fault. But I just
– No.
I just think that, you know, that's going to be a big test for him to kind of prove what he really is, at least yeah. on the defensive end.
Okay, so for conference, give me, like, two you're looking forward to.
Oh, I mean, I think that it's pretty easy to say the Richmond games. I mean, you look at the minutes that they've returned versus the minutes Flu's returned, and I think that obviously those are going to be phenomenal games. I do think that the number one, the first one that I'm looking forward to is going to be December 30th against Duquesne, because that is going to kick off the conference schedule. We know how Flu struggled with Duquesne last year, and I think that, you know, it's kind of important to start the conference season 1-0, because if you started 0-1, and that's not to say that all is lost, but you start to get, you know, a lot more people talking about, you know, what is this team, and are they as good as people thought they were going to be? And, you know, if you lose that first game, it's easy to still go 17-1, or I shouldn't say it's easy, but, you know, it's possible. And so you obviously have that tough test early. And I think that Slew might come out with a little bit of vigor that they want that win after not getting it either time last year.
Yeah, and I think that that's a great – that's also one of my games that I'm kind of circling. So if you come out to Duquesne, a team that kicked you in the teeth twice last year, you know, if you come out and you beat them by any margin, it could be 5, it could be 10, whatever it is, but if you come out and you say, hey, we're not the same team that we were last year, we're not going to lose to these guys who they just dumped it into Marcus Weathers, and he was the one guy who really bullied Hassan in both matchups. You know, if you come out and you start your conference year and you say, hey, the team that had our number last year, they don't have our number anymore, that's a big statement for the rest of the league. And I think the other one I'm looking forward to, you did hit Richmond, but I'm looking forward to both of the Dayton games. There are a lot of people on Twitter and kind of around the nation at large that are talking a lot of really good things about Dayton, even though they lost Obi Toppin and Ryan Mikesell, and there was a third player they might have lost, Trey Landers, maybe? I don't remember the exact name. But they lost three of their big contributors from last season. But they still have Jalen Crutcher. They still have E.B. Watson. They have some other guys that, you know, are good. But I would love, after losing those two games to Dayton last year in heartbreaking fashion, to just come and sweep them this year and just say, hey, we have good players too. Let's have a new leaf. And because the game at Dayton, like, I'm looking at KenPom right now. In conference, you only have two games that project as quad A or quad one, whatever they are, your top tier games for net purposes, and that is at Richmond and at Dayton. Everything else is either a B or worse. So you really need to take advantage of those opportunities, or else you're not really going to be able to build a resume effectively without winning the league.
Right. And I actually think that I guess kind of going back to the schedule for a second, I think that one more that I'm really kind of waiting for, because it makes me a little nervous, I think a little more nervous than it should, is the game away to St. Joseph's, because just watching Ryan Daly torch Slew last year, it was painful to watch, even though Slew was able to sneak that one out. I'd like to see, you know, what kind of adjustments can get made to limit him. And I mean, he is going to score points, and he is going to be, I mean, he's a great player.
He is.
And that's what great players do, but you have to be able to limit him at least for part of the game. So
St. Joe's is going to be an interesting team this year because they have a ton of transfers. They're very similar to Rhode Island, except people think their transfers are much worse. in the sense that Daly might not have the usage he had last year. I don't know if that's going to help or hurt them, but, you know, Daly might not be chucking 25 times a game. I think he should. I think there's an argument to be made he might be the best scorer in the conference because he's a efficient player who, you know, is hard to guard. He's 6'5".
Right.
And like, sneakily quick. But, yeah, I think that could be a trap game. I mean, there could be, like, UMass last year beat SLU in a pretty heartbreaking fashion the second time they played when Trey Mitchell went off. Like,
right.
There's a lot of games in your conference slate that can hurt you, and they can hurt you pretty bad. But I think that's a good place to talk. I don't think we mentioned this earlier, but right now on both of the stats sites that we look at, so T-Rank and KenPom, I'm going to start with T-Rank because they actually have all the conference games loaded. T-Rank is projecting SLU to finish 14-4 in conference. Now, granted, that could change. It's based on confidence intervals. These numbers are going to change a ton after every team gets a few games in. And he's also projecting SLU to finish 21-5 overall. I'm just going to look at KenPom for conference because he doesn't have the updated full season. KenPom is projecting SLU to finish 12-5 in conference, but that's with the caveat that the game at St. Bonaventure is not loaded yet because it doesn't have a confirmed date. So he's either projecting SLU 12-6 or 13-5, give or take. I'm trying to see. There was something else I wanted to talk about the schedule, but unless you have anything, then we can just move on to who we think is going to progress or who's going to be the keys to this season.
Now I'm ready to kind of move on here.
Cool. So I think before we wrap up, I think that it's a good thing to talk about who do we think that this season is going to hinge on in terms of players, whether it's someone getting better or someone just performing as they were. Who do you think, like, the two most important guys are on this team for them to be, whether they get an at-large or they win the conference or whatever?
Oh, I'd say, you know, I think two guys that it really hinges on. I mean, I think it's very easy to say any of the three seniors. I mean, obviously, we talked about before how they're pretty known qualities. You kind of know what you're going to get. We expect double doubles. We expect Javonte to score. I mean Javonte scored in double figures every game except for two after the calendar changed in 2020 last year. And one was that very first one in the new year. So,
yeah.
I mean, you expect probably double figures from Javonte. You expect double doubles from Jordan Fasan. But I think that two guys that it's really going to hinge on is, I think number one is Yuri and him just being able to show growth and maturity. I mean, for as talented as he was a freshman last year. And
yeah.
he got a lot of starting minutes. And I think that was really good for him. And I think that, seeing how he can develop, whether that's cutting turnovers, maybe getting even more assists, shooting a little bit better, maybe being a little more aggressive. I mean, there's a lot of things that he can do, and he is a really good player for how young he is, and I think that he's kind of an important piece because he's the one that most of the time is tying in the different guys, whether that be the wings or, you know, the postman or whoever you want, but he's the guy that's running the transition. He's the guy that's setting up the offense. And I think just him showing the maturity and the control, I think will be a big piece this year. And I think the second guy who we haven't really talked about, and I'll be honest, I don't know a ton about him.
Yeah.
I think Martin Linson.
Yeah.
I think he's the guy that, I mean, we don't think he's going to be in the starting lineup. That doesn't mean he's not going to get quality minutes, but we just don't think he's going to be in the starting lineup, certainly not at the beginning of the year. But he's a guy who I think can really fill in and give you those minutes with Hassan on the bench, whether that be, you know, 10 minutes at the end of the first half when he's in foul trouble, whether that be just kind of filler minutes here and there. I think that he's a guy who can kind of be that post defense along with,
yeah,
obviously you have a big guy in Jimmy, but I think that he's a guy that is a little bit underrated and almost maybe a little bit forgotten about. I mean, I know I do sometimes. So I think that if he can be effective in the areas that Travis needs him, I mean, the team doesn't need him to score 15 a game.
No.
They just need him to be effective and to be efficient. And I think that he can be certainly helpful in what they're trying to accomplish this year.
Yeah, the addition of him to the roster reminds me a lot of Tay Weaver last year, where he is a guy who has produced at lower levels, but seems like he's just trying to join a winning program at this point. One thing I like about Linson a lot is that he has plus rebounding rates.
Right.
If you look at his raw rebounding numbers, you might be like, oh, he averaged like 4.5 boards last year. This guy can't rebound for a guy who's a big man. But if you look at his percentages, he rebounds at a very above average rate. He just doesn't, he didn't have the minutes to like dictate these huge rebounding numbers, but he's someone that like you said, if you take Hassan out, you're not going to lose much on the boards with him. And right, also,
exactly.
Also he is just under the average for free throw shooting for the country. I think he was like 68% last year. So he's a guy that at the end of the game, you can put in for defense and rebounding. Who's not going to kill you at the line.
Right. He's a career 65% free throw shooter is what I'm seeing. So which, I think that's quality for, you know, this whole team that we're looking at that we're using.
Yeah. So I think quickly my two key guys are first. I think it's Gibson Jimerson. I think that a lot of SLU's offensive woes last year revolved around the fact that until Javonte broke out, you could just pack the lane and dare SLU to shoot. I think that the re-addition of Jimerson to the lineup is going to take that away. I especially if he's on the court at the same time as Perkins or Jacobs, or maybe all three at the same time, that's really going to take teams away from being able to clog the lane and just double and sometimes even triple Hassan and Jordan when they would get down there. And then I think the other guy, I believe you mentioned him, is one of your two, but is Jurie. I think that if Jurie is able to cut down on his turnovers just a bit, he doesn't even need to increase his assists per se, but if he can cut down on his turnovers a bit and just improve his shooting a little bit, like he showed a decent stroke from outside. He didn't shoot that often, but he shot threes every once in a while, and he gave teams a look. If he can give teams a look, improve his free throws a little bit, which you can say across the board, but if he can do that, he's going to be a really hard player for teams to stop. As like anytime he's on the court, unless he's on the court at the same time as Jimmy, he's the fifth option. He's your fifth option.
Right. I agree. And I think that one of the points with that is, you know, we want him to cut down on turnovers. And I think that that will happen. Or it should happen just because he will have now played with these guys for over 12 months at this point. Because, I mean, we saw a lot of turnovers last year where he made, you know, a wild pass, and it was a good pass, and guys just weren't looking for the ball. And it would hit him and go out of bounds. And, you know, you can't really put – I mean, Jurie gets credited with the turnover. You can't really put that on him. I mean, it's tough to really put on either guy when you're not expecting – you know, a crazy behind-the-back pass or something that goes across the lane. But I think that just by nature of being in practice more, having played with him a full season, I think that you're going to see guys really look for those passes a little bit more.
Yeah. And then I want to finish on this. So this kind of all rolls in together. We're talking about numbers. Both of us are lucky enough to live in the state of Illinois where we have legal sports betting. Right now, at most books, I just checked FanDuel, but SLU is plus 220 to win the conference. So for those of you unfamiliar with betting, anything that's minus means that they're favorites, so to speak. It's tough when doing future bets for conference, but SLU is the favorite to win conference at plus 220. Do you think at this point, sitting here on November 23rd, that is a good investment for people, or would you hold off a little bit longer into the season?
I'd say it's certainly not a bad investment. It's tough. It's tough to know with, you know, potential injuries. I mean, obviously we saw Jimerson, come down with a bad injury last December that really affects your offense. Luckily, I mean, it's always possible. It could be, you know, a guy in a bigger role.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's something that can really affect it. But, I mean, I think that what you'd really want to do, I think that the play there would probably be, I know that off the top of my head, I know that Slew's the favorite at plus 220. I know that Richmond's about 250.
Yeah, and then I think Dayton's like
300, 400?
Three something. I mean, it's not – the thing is that based on all statistical indicators and Vegas odds makers, most people, all of these sources come to a consensus that there's a clear top three in the conference and that your order is, you know, it can change based on what flavor you're into.
Right. But, and I think that, sorry, finish.
No, I was going to say that Dayton's plus 330. So it's not a tremendous difference. It's, you know, it's 33%. Less likely based on sure. My simple math in my head, but that's according to what Vegas thinks. So
I think that honestly, the best bet is probably to pick two of those top three,
yeah,
and split your money between those because you'll come out ahead if either of them wins.
Correct. So,
I think that that's probably where the smart money is. Obviously, you're going to lose one half of that bet,
so you'll
make it back plus some with if the other one wins.
Yeah, so, loosely.
I think that's where the smart bet is, to be honest.
Yeah.
So I do want to ask one more, John.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. So I have one more. I did want to say we've got, what, two games this week? I want your predictions for those two games. Give me a win or loss. Give me a score prediction.
Okay. I think SIU Edwardsville is a win.
Okay.
I think that SLU is going to score. I think it's going to be 76 to 58.
Okay.
I'm a little less optimistic than both of these places on how much they're going to score. Maybe SIU's defense is that bad. I really don't know. Or maybe SLU just has unlocked something. Then I think LSU. I think LSU SLU is going to win. I think it's going to be 70 to 66. I think another low-ish scoring game.
Okay. I am going to say, I'm going to also call them both a win. I mean, we might be biased here, but that's okay.
I'm 100% biased.
Correct. But I am going to say against Edwardsville, I'm going to go with 82 to 49. I think it's going to be a blowout.
Oh.
I saw how they opened against Florida Gulf Coast. Obviously, it's a completely different year. I think the shooting's there. I think the defense is there. I think they're going to try to come on hot and really show everybody who they are.
Yeah.
I think that it's going to be a big win. So I'm going to go 82 to 49. And then against LSU, I think it's going to be a dogfight. I think they're going to win. I think it's going to be a classic SLU defensive dogfight.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 58-53.
Oh, wow. I was going to say, after you started talking, I could see that LSU game is one where both teams struggle to crack 60. Like, just that take the air out of the ball, really low possession crap that, like,
right.
Travis loves to play, unfortunately. But, yeah, I mean, by and large, we're both expecting wins. I'm on KenPom. So we have two games this week. One game next week. So
yeah, I believe it's just Saturday next week.
Yeah, Arkansas Pine Bluff. So, you know, we're slowly but steadily getting basketball, but once we get around to conference, we should be back to some normalcy of an A-10 schedule unless they decide to shake that up too. But thank you, everybody, for listening to our first episode. We are going to have a lot more to talk about the more numbers we actually get in. If for some reason you're listening but don't follow us on Twitter, shoot us a follow at West Pine Bills, spelled exactly how you would expect it to be, unless you don't know how to spell, which would be kind of unfortunate. But thank you all for listening, and go Bills. Hope you have two wins this week. I wonder how many times you've been here.